what is the essential problem that this book addresses? And I'm really interested in how it came to you, whether it was like this epiphany or this dawning sense that something was deeply wrong with the way we report war, and especially American involved invasion and that kind of thing.
Right.
And where the it's obviously there's a political problem, but also an artistic problem, it seems to me. And if you could just sort of talk about that a little, and then I zero in on some of the journalism issues.
Totally. Well,
I mean, obviously, I could talk for half an hour on that question. I'll try and be relatively concise. But, you know, I'm a lifelong reader of the New York Times, you know, and in the last 10, 12 years, beginning with the Gulf, well, certainly the Gulf War in 91, and then especially with the invasion of Afghanistan and Iraq, as I would get that blue-bagged copy of the paper to my front porch every morning, I would find myself, you know, problematically riveted by these photographs. I couldn't wait for what I came to call my sort of installation of war porn. You know, something seemed wrong in this transaction. I couldn't tell if it was something the matter with my imagination, something was the matter with the Times, or perhaps in the exchange between the Times and me. But New York Times color photo started on page A1 in October of 97. I think it seemed to usher in a kind of sea change in Times war photography. So anyway, I found myself baffled by how ravishingly beautiful these photographs were. And I found myself admiring these pictures, being impressed by them, sort of loving them, but really hating how much I loved these photographs. And so I set myself the career suicide path, you know, that you're not, as a writer in the United States, supposed to write a book-length critique of the New York Times, which is still the most influential newspaper in the country, if not possibly the English-speaking world. But I was sort of baffled by my reaction. So I set myself the research task of asking some more digitally skilled photo assistants and I that we went through and looked through 4,500, or in a way sort of 9,000 front pages of the New York Times going all the way back to 91. And we looked at every front page of the Times. I think we found 1,000 combat photos on page A1, and we found, I believe, 700 of those 1,000 pics struck me as aestheticizing and aesthetizing war. That the pictures seemed to not be very invested in conveying what I would assume is the horror of war, and they seemed instead crazily invested in what I think of as glamorizing the war, beautifying the war, sanctifying and sanitizing the war. And if these pictures had been of, say, pictures on the front page of the Wall Street Journal or USA Today, or if it was a video collage at Fox News, there would be no story here. But the Times has, or had, probably still has, a unique role in American culture. The writer Seymour Krim once called it the commissar of the real, that the Times is this weird arbiter of American culture. People still say, you know, New York Times best-selling author, as if that is different from being a Boston Globe best-selling author. I mean, the Times has this weird hold still slightly on the cultural conversation. The Times is understood to be sort of impartial or even slightly center-left. And it really baffled me as a longtime reader and half admirer of the Times, which I thought of as a place of serious journalism, the Fourth Estate, all the news that's fit to print, the first draft of history, et cetera, et cetera. So I spent years, Fred, accumulating all of these photographs. I kept on looking for course corrections, begging to be released from this suicide mission. Please don't allow me to publish this book. I kept on looking for New York Times picks that showed me that my argument was actually wrong. But I found precious few photographs that struck me as documenting the horror of war. So I worked together. I gathered about sort of 700 photographs. I got them down to, I remember this incredible meeting with my research assistants where we met in a basement classroom on the UW campus a few years ago. And we poured all of the pictures into sort of thematic piles, so that all the pictures that struck us as war, as fashion shoot, we all put in one pile. All the pics that struck us as war, as movie trailer, we put in this other pile. All the pictures that struck us as modern masterpiece paintings, we put in a third pile. And we developed about 15 thematically driven piles, and we all sort of looked at each other, like Woodward and Bernstein at the Watergate Hotel. We kind of said, you know, there's a story here. What are these pictures doing on the front page of the New York Times? I wasn't only reading these pictures in a paranoid way. The evidence was staring us in our collective faces. So at that point, that we knew we had a book, in a way, my favorite moment of doing the book was that moment where we all looked at each other and realized we had the book. Then it was a long and somewhat tedious process of getting the pictures digitally ready, finding a publisher, having the publisher buy licensing fees, choosing our key 64 photos that fit our 10 thematic categories, finding quotations that prefaced every chapter, writing the introduction, getting the art critic Dave Hickey to write the afterword, and the end result is this really beautiful book, I think. I mean, it's no praise to me. I think the publisher did a really beautiful job. Someone called it, you know, it is this sort of problematically beautiful book, where it's this sort of museum quality book that is supposed to be a kind of perverse coffee table book, in which the pictures are ravishingly beautiful and you're supposed to feel disgusted and repelled and furious at how gorgeous the photographs are. And so, anyway, Fred, that's my long-winded answer to how the book came to be.
What's your sense of, and maybe it's too complicated of an answer, but is there an agenda behind this?
Or on my part or the Times?
The Times. And is it political? Is it artistic? Is it to sell ads? You've talked about these pictures in context where colors will flow through photographs down to the ad at the bottom of the page.
This is something, this was the Times, Monday, November the 16th, 2015, after the Paris bombings about 2 months ago. And it's something that war photographers talk about off the record, that, you know, it's just a legitimate design concern in which a war photographer will say, you know, do you have a pic, will be asked, do you have a picture with orange in the picture? Do you have a picture of a dying soldier with orange in the background? Which sounds disgusting, but it's a, you know, this is finally a commercial operation. So in a paper like this, I happen to be in New York City on a book tour for this book, and so I, you know, I pulled the front page of the picture of the paper, and you know, there's a lot of red for this a tie advertisement, and that clearly bounces off of this beautiful French woman's red lips and that rhymes with these hundreds of dead red flowers in these bouquets of flowers. And then on the top of the headline is France strikes ISIS targets in Syria in retaliation for attacks on Paris. And I don't know how you guys read that this front page. On some level, you could just say it's a front page, and why are you making such a big deal out of it? But to me, when you put together that headline, those hundreds or thousands of fallen flowers, and this sort of mythically sort of classic French beauty on the front page of the picture of the paper, this kind of argument is being messaged, or a kind of argument is getting manufactured. In Noam Chomsky's phrase, consent is getting manufactured. This is how we as lambs are led to slaughter. It's Schopenhauer's phrase. But to me, a kind of argument sneaks through these images, which is, we can't allow Helen of Troy to be killed, that we can't allow her to become a fallen flower. Bombing begins in 5 minutes. There's a kind of subtle argument going on here. And again, there's no way in which the Times is consciously saying that or thinking about that. But in a way, if I have an agenda in the book, it's to question the unblinking beauty of these images that the Times is sending a somewhat encrypted, somewhat coded cultural message. These pictures dignify and enable and ennoble war. They make war seem dignified and in a way necessary. And I want us to worry about these pictures more than the Times does. The way I sometimes say it is, the design department is running the War Department here. And that seems to me at least worth talking about.
Well, it seems particularly egregious there, since the story is about bombing in Syria and all the pictures are from Paris.
That's a really good point. That's a really good point.
The thing that sort of leapt to my mind when I first looked through this book was, years ago when I was at the Seattle Times, every Christmas the newsroom would put up a Christmas tree and it would be completely covered in homemade ornaments, and the ornaments were all war and riot photographs from around the world that had never been published, and they were completely uncensored and completely graphic close-ups of the faces of people hanging from trees and mutilated bodies and all the things that photographers have to witness and record but never make it into the public record, because somewhere between on the scene reporting and reporting to the public, something happens. And the juxtaposition or the jarring difference between the images on that tree and the images in this book really speaks to my mind to the sense, I think, among on-the-scene reporters that there is a really deep hypocrisy going on in the kind of overarching mission.
Yeah, that's something that, you know, I've heard from some of the photographers whose pictures I've used in the book. I mean, some of them probably like the book, some of them probably don't. Some of them have gone on record as finding the book of interest. Some of them have reached out to me. But off the record, they have said that, you know, and some of this is on the record in quotations, that inevitably their best pictures don't make it into, for instance, the Times, for two main reasons. One, quote, the pictures are too violent. I mean, they are, after all, of war. And the second one is they're in, quote, bad taste. And I guess I often think, in a way, I came across this quote after I had completed the book. It's a wonderful quote of Picasso's, who says, "The enemy of great art is good taste." And I feel like so many of these pictures are, you know, exquisitely, gorgeously, repellently tasteful. You know, like, where is the war here? And, you know, like, there's a line of the Civil War general, William Tecumseh Sherman, who famously said, war is hell. You know, that phrase has entered the culture at this point, you know, 150 years later. It's become even a sort of cliche. And I feel that as I look through these 9,000 photographs from Time's A1 pictures from 91 until just last year, I had the feeling that to the Times, the message the Times is sending to its readers is not that war is hell, but that war is a kind of very pretty and very distant heck. You know, like, that war seems like a kind of hazy, gooey, gorgeous, heckish place, but it's not truly hell. And I would want to say that's, to me, pretty problematic. And I guess the $64,000 question, as Fred implies, is to what degree is the Times consciously promulgating this message? I don't think the Times, as I say, has a secret room in which they say, okay, we have to make sure, you know, 1,000 soldiers die this month. I mean, obviously, it's nothing as nefarious as that. And I have a whole argument, which I can unleash later, as to why I think the really noble tradition of combat photography, which in a way began with Matthew Brady and continued through many Times war photographers through Vietnam in the last 40 years, has badly devolved into becoming a kind of combat porn.
Do you think some of that is reaction to what happened in Vietnam?
In that, what exact sense do you mean?
In the sense that Vietnam seemed to turn everybody deeply skeptical about government promotion of war. And it just seems to me that media, even if it's unconscious, has become somewhat of a war promoter. Like, there was this big debate in the Bush administration about not showing...
Bush 41 or 43?
43, not showing the returning coffins.
Sure.
I can't remember who it was, I heard on the radio one day saying that Americans had been conditioned to thinking of war as a kind of armed social work. And that's the way it is promoted, like, we're liberating, we're setting women free, we're doing... But nobody wants to talk about the carnage.
Right.
I mean, there's a lot of questions there, but I do think, you know, there are a lot of reasons as to why combat photo. And again, the Times isn't really my target. I mean, I don't really care one way or the other about the Times in the sense that I could have done the Kansas City Star, Des Moines Register, or the Boston Globe, or the LA Times, or for that matter, the Seattle Times. But, you know, the Times was my case study. It has traction in the English-speaking world as very few other papers do. But you know, there's a whole series of reasons as to why the Times after Vietnam has changed its photo policy. One, I think, is an all-volunteer army, so that the typical reader of the Times is terribly unlikely to be a soldier in Iraq or Afghanistan. You know, you look at the roll call of the dead every day, you know, they're always often a person of color from, you know, Plano, Texas. They're not an upper middle class kid from Westchester, New York. Two, I think the embedding of journalists and photojournalists with troops was a huge change, so that the very people you're taking pictures of, you're then sleeping in the same barracks and foxholes with the very next day. And I think the journalists and photojournalists are less likely to print scarifying, scathing, truth-telling photographs. I also think to the rise of the web, the ubiquity of digital media and the decline of print journalism has left, for instance, the New York Times in an incredibly precarious position, so that an image, so first of all, it's trying to hold on to a dwindling so-called market share, and second of all, it's fully aware that an image it prints is going to go around the world absolutely instantaneously. So it prints what seem like relatively anodyne photographs, such as this picture of fallen bouquets and a beautiful young Parisian woman. And I guess that part of the argument is that behind these seemingly anodyne photographs, there's a huge cultural message getting sent, that by not printing and showing and documenting and exploring the true horror and cost and blood of war, it ends up making war seem both very distant and really cool. I'm trying to think of a couple other reasons I've mentioned quite a few of the reasons. I think, too, the huge push of right-wing think tanks, whether it's, you know, the Koch brothers or Richard Mellon Skiaf, these sort of multi-billion dollar think tanks, have pushed centrist media toward the right. As you know, there's an endless sort of gotcha game if a media outlet such as NPR or The Times in any way leans slightly left. So I think a lot of these media outlets have leaned right, or at least very broadly centrist and falsely balanced. And I also think for the last 40 years, all of these photographers and photo editors and page designers have gone to school on abstract expressionism. They've all been to art school. They've all studied the modern masterpieces such as Andy Warhol. If you call these masterpieces, you know, we can argue about whether they're great or not, but, you know, a lot of abstract expressionist beauty, Gerhard Richter, Jasper Johns, Mark Rothko, Richard Diebenkorn, Jackson Pollock, you know, kind of gorgeous abstract expressionism, I think has seeped into the bones of every photographer, every photo page designer, every photo editor. And in a way, all of these pictures are aspiring. I could have done the whole book, I sort of wish that I had. I could have done the whole book as nothing but war as modern masterpiece paintings, because picture after picture after picture is it seems a conscious attempt to replicate major paintings from 1950 through 2000. And as a result, there's a kind of reverence for sheer physical and painterly and pictorial beauty, and to me, almost no interest in documenting war consequence. I mean, during Vietnam, to return to Fred's question, LBJ, the president, Lyndon Johnson, said, "I can't win this war without the support of the New York Times." And the Times during Vietnam published some iconic and powerful photographs, some of which won the Pulitzer Prize, some of which a lot of people argue helped to end the Vietnam War slightly earlier than it would have otherwise ended. And I think even as recently as 2013, the Times ran an article called something like "The 13 Most Important Pictures from the Vietnam War." And then I couldn't help but ask, you know, where are those the 13 most important questions from Afghanistan and a rack, they're definitely not in the New York Times for a variety of reasons I've tried to suggest.
Do you think, one of the, I think, really powerful arguments in your book is about not so much the image itself, but composition, and that gets back to the question of painting.
Right.
But it seems to me that somewhere between Vietnam and the present time, the journalistic mission has been kind of corrupted by artistic pretension or the artistic mission, and I don't know how much of that has to do with technology and the ability to manipulate photos that didn't used to be there, and the fact that they're in color now and they didn't used to be.
That's huge. I mean, I don't think it's a coincidence that all these pictures are from 97 afterward. I looked at stuff pre-97, pre-color, but there's something, it's almost, well anyway, I didn't mean to break in, Fred.
I was just wondering what you're thinking about kind of that, I guess, complicated question between the mission of the journalist as opposed to what someone might think of their mission as an artist,
right,
as a photo editor, as artist, or a photographer as artist. Because even though you crop these things, you've probably seen the original picture of Che Guevara in before they cropped it and became so iconic.
Sure.
And I kind of feel like that drives a lot of these people now, just the idea that they can create something that goes beyond reporting.
Right.
Yeah, I just wonder how corrupting that can be.
I mean, there's whole series of debates online and elsewhere about the role of the photographer in a hyper-digitized world. You know, oftentimes, you know, the whole debate about Robert Capa's photograph that people realized many years later during the Spanish Civil War was a completely staged photograph. We all now know now that Iwo Jima was, of course, completely staged. The photo of pulling the Saddam statue off was staged. A photo that won, you know, the best war photo of I think 2013 was thought was some people have proved online that it had been sort of digitally manipulated or so they claimed. And I think that my argument is partly there. I don't have any particular proof that, you know, these 64 photographs have been shot through with infrared light or anything like that. And it's less that argument, although it's partly that. And I think what happened, and the book came out 2 months ago, and you know, when a book gets published, you get reviews, you know, some people like it, some people don't. I'm trying to think of the criticism if people have, when people push back against it, the criticism is that I'm sort of throwing the beauty out with the bathwater, that how dare David Shields, who isn't a war photographer, who's not a war journalist, who's not a photo critic, I can barely take a picture on my camera phone, but how dare he question beauty? Like, I think one article in one magazine says something like, must a picture be ugly to convey the horror of war, or something like that. As if, I mean, that's not what I'm saying, and you just go back through combat photography. I mean, Matthew Brady's photographs, who in a sense invented war photography, they were highly staged, highly manipulated, gorgeously composed, but they convey the grotesquery of a decaying body. And so too during World War II, the best World War II photographers, whether Karsh, Robert Capa, any number of photographers, have pictures that convey, you know, the terror and awfulness of war. And so too during Vietnam, people like Larry Burroughs and David Hume Kennerly and many New York Times employees took very powerful war photos. I think for me, I want greater intentionality and greater purpose and greater, I think what happens, the Times photos seem willfully oblivious to the plastic nature of their beauty. I mean, I don't know if you have, Fred and I were talking over dinner about some of these pictures. This was a picture as recently as November 12, 2015, of, it says, Kurdish fighters killed in 2014 in Kobani were buried last month in Qamishli, sorry if I'm mangling these pronunciations. Recovery of the bodies had been impossible before. And so this is page A1. And the picture looks like a Vogue magazine fashion shoot. I mean, it's as if they did a search for the single most beautiful woman on the planet and had her be the principal barrier. And I can show you picture after picture after picture after picture like that. And so many of my viewings of the Times pictures is really, really, that's the picture you went with? You know, I mean, this is all very conscious choice in the sense that, see what happened to that picture we had before, Fred, the... Yeah, oh, there it is. You know, like, of all the pictures, we have France strikes ISIS targets, as Fred said, in Syria, not in Paris, in Syria, in retaliation for attacks on Paris. And so what's the picture? This stunningly beautiful blonde red lipstick Parisian beauty. Really? That's the picture? That's the picture? I don't know, that seems to me a real problem. And it's not that that isn't a good photo or you couldn't run that picture. I just found in my study of literally 9,000 A1 photographs over the last almost 25 years, precious little course correction on the Times part. Like you could say, what's the harm? I would see relatively little harm, you know, occasionally there would be a picture of a soldiers playing baseball or soldiers swimming or a pretty image of a spent shell casing against an orange sunset or a weirdly gorgeous Gerhard Richter-like photograph of a car bombing that makes the car bombing look oddly glamorous. If these were balanced by a more wrenching attempt to convey war, I'd be a less displeased former subscriber. I mean, one thing I've tried to point out is that, you know, a lot of war journalism, prose journalism, print coverage has been monumentally better and more searing and more ambitious in its attempt to convey the cost of war. Any number of British and American journalists, mainly American journalists, whether it's Steve Cole, Lawrence Wright, any number of intrepid American war reporters who are reporting or have been reporting, had been reporting, at least one of whom had been a New York Times reporter, have written books, long articles that convey, not that all reporting about war has to be only, quote, anti-war, but I would want a much more nuanced account of war in prose and photo that under the guise of neutrality isn't actually conveying how sexily glamorous war is through studiously neutral and monumental photographs. I guess that's a large part of these things. These pictures always seem to find a way to make war seem really civilized and sort of, I just think of monumental, kind of dignified and meaningful. That's not what war feels like. It feels like a I don't pretend to have been a soldier or a war reporter, but a lot of friends and friends' fathers have served in war, and it ain't like that. Don't know if we want to open it up yet for questions, Fred, or if you want to investigate me further. Questions, Ed?
Yeah, you were talking about Vietnam and how it's kind of changed, and you were saying that you didn't think they sit in a room, which is what Chomsky always says, they're not in a room.
Like consciously saying, how can we bury more soldiers? But anyway, Ed.
Yeah, and I just remember that one photograph of the napalm children.
Sure.
And I think that one photograph probably did more to turn the tide of opinion than pretty much anything.
Totally. And it's a famous photograph by the New York Times photographer, Nick Ut. I mean, he wasn't hired by the Times, but that picture, I'm almost certain, appeared in the Times. And that picture changed Nick Ut's life, of course. And the Times ran that picture. And what has changed in the last 40 years that picture could no more appear in the Times than a Mickey Mouse commercial?
Yeah.
But anyway, Ed, finish your thought or your question.
I know that there was pressure after that on the different, especially the Times, not to do that. And a
totally.
Big tantrum, you know, by the administration.
Of course.
So, you know, I think there is pressure, and we
absolutely.
Know that, you know, we don't hear about it all the time, but
totally.
Sometimes that gets exposed.
Absolutely. I mean, it's very complicated, the dance by which the Times instantiates its authority by appeasing the government, and the government instantiates its authority by courting the Times. It's a very complicated and very problematic symbiosis. You know, the Times' brand is that it's sort of serious journalism, but its brand is also that it has access to the highest levels of government. And one of the arguments of the book is, you know, I want to question the Times. I want us to look toward a more European model of journalism. You know, if you're in, say, London, you see maybe 15 newspapers from the far left to the far right, and each paper occupies consciously a place on the political spectrum. It leads with its own subjectivity and doesn't pretend to be all things to all people the way the Times does. The Times tries to be both the paper of record and also also serious investigative journalism. And part of the argument that I unleash in the introduction of the book is that it's a very, you know, kind of a complicated argument, but that the Times was founded by German Jews in 1851 and was properly criticized for during World War II underplaying the full atrocity of the Holocaust. The Times has long been accused by anti-Semites of being, quote, too Jewish of a newspaper through the 20s and 30s and 40s and even beyond. A lot of people think, because of the paper was founded by German Jews, that the Times overcorrected and basically, you know, consciously underreported the full extent of the Holocaust, lest the paper be understood to be either, quote, too German or too Jewish. And it's my contention that part of the paper's agenda, especially post-Vietnam, is to never occupy anything else other than a deeply centrist role vis-a-vis the United States government. So over the last 70 years, from the end of World War II until now, the Times has, with almost no exceptions, broadly supported every American military misadventure. And it seems to me an attempt to make sure it occupies a manly American and military role in relationship to the culture and isn't perceived to be sort of left-wing or European or sort of, you know, Jewish dissident. What other thoughts do people have? Questions?
Well, I think that's really interesting. But it's this idea of the New York Times is, we talk about Stephen Colbert calling the reporters like Judith Miller and John Byrne stenographers for the administration.
Absolutely.
Reporting the invasion of Iraq.
Totally.
They pretty much printed what the administration told them in an unquestioning way. And you've seen these pictures as kind of in the same vein as that. And I think that's really important. And your words about the Fourth Estate, what is the role of the Fourth Estate and the New York Times as part of this? And I think you got to it tonight, but I wondered if you'd like to say a little more.
Thank you. I have a couple of comments. Is one, Colbert is relevant in the sense that I think that Colbert and Jon Stewart did a fantastic job when they were on. You know, I think Colbert has a talk show now that I think I gather is more conventional. But, you know, they did a good job of sort of calling out, sort of shooting fish in the proverbial barrel, where they would point out how a Fox News broadcast is transparently propagandistic and or hypocritical and or bad faith. Or CNN, they'd make fun, you know, of Anderson Cooper, or they'd make fun of Republican and Democratic presidential candidates. But I think, again, and they did a great job of educating an entire generation toward media literacy about how propaganda works. But I think in a strange way, the Times had and has escaped relative scrutiny because it occupies this pseudo role as this quasi-neutral arbiter of American culture, that we uniquely are weirdly printing the truth and are weirdly neutral. That's just an absurd role to pretend to occupy. But there was, what was something else you said that I wanted to follow up? Oh, yeah, the whole sort of Fourth Estate and the Times. And how does the Times do that? I don't know. I'm sort of forgetting. What was it you said at the end? You said something about the Times. Oh, yeah, the role of journalism.
Yeah,
it was that a 19th century journalist, I think his name is Peter Finlay Dunn or Peter Dunn Finlay or some combination of those three names, and he said that the role of journalism, the function of journalism, is to afflict the comfortable and comfort the afflicted. And maybe he was more of an activist journalist than we're comfortable with now. But perhaps as the son of activist journalists, you know, I'm finally fulfilling the parental mandate, you know, and embracing that. You know, I think, to go back to the Picasso line, you know, the enemy of great art is good taste. The enemy of good journalism is deference to authority. You know, I think, well, sometimes people ask me what art is. And to me, if I had to say one word for art, art is trouble. When you create art, you should be creating trouble. I'm a big fan of a line of Gustave Flaubert who said, the value of a work of art can be measured by the harm spoken of it. Like, think of, why am I forgetting the name of the woman who created the Vietnam War Memorial? Maya Lin, of course. Do you remember the amazing, she was a very young architecture student at Yale studying under Vincent Scully, and she'd been studying Roman and Greek funeral statuary, and she, on a whim, submitted her idea to the competition. And remember, the Vietnam veterans created this more, in a way, straight out of a Times War photo of, you know, the vets holding the guns in the typical way, and they wanted that as competing against Maya Lin. Just think of all of the trouble that Maya Lin's powerful underground burial created for so many years, and now you could hardly imagine a more iconic work of art in American culture. You know, good art creates sorrow and trouble and difficulty. And, you know, even going back to Nick Ut's photograph of the girl, the Vietnamese girl running naked through napalm, I'm sure that disturbed people. So that when there was an article in some magazine about the book and about War is Beautiful, and so they asked the Times photo editor what she thought of the book, and she goes, well, I haven't looked at his book yet, but he should remember that we published this one picture in, well, I can't even read it, July something. And I don't know if I have a better image of it, but that she told the magazine that, well, that's not true, that we publish really disturbing images, and a lot of our readers, were upset by this picture, and the best they could come up with, I'm sorry, I can't quite read the image, it looks like maybe July 11th, 2014, and, you know, it's just a very anodyne image of a body buried under, what would you call it, like a plastic sheet, and you can see a little bit of the dead person's feet, and there's a red flower, I believe, or on the top. if this to them, I mean, you know, it's hard to see, and you can't really tell the image. But if this is the closest the Times gets to war, we're in quite serious trouble. What other sort of final thoughts or questions or concerns or even pushback do people have? How am I getting? I'm not everyone agrees with my reading of these pictures. I'm not sure I agree with my reading of all these pictures. I mean, does anyone see flaws in my argument? How am I overreading the pictures? Am I asking too much of what's, after all, simply a daily newspaper?
Do you think the internet is making this all irrelevant?
Well, I think in the sense that a lot of my students, you know, I'm 59, I was born in 56 in LA, and I grew up in LA and San Francisco, and as I say, both of my parents were journalists, and, you know, I grew up with the Times as this kind of received truth, and the Times sort of mattered or matters to me, whereas a lot of my students say, like, why are you getting all hot and bothered about the New York Times? Who cares what the Times publishes? It's just one more paywall website. You know, they don't really care. And I think I welcome that. I mean, I guess I'm all for a democratized culture. I'm all for that. One of the implications of the book, I think, is we should first of all question authority, question the establishment. We should look toward more decentralized media, and that we should be our own best reporters and our own best photographers. A lot of the best coverage, certainly the best photographs that came out of, say, the Paris bombings, came from, not from embedded photojournalists, but from this one Danish blogger who conveyed these amazing images through his blog site. And so too in Iraq and Afghanistan, a lot of the images that I've seen that convey much more of what the war is like come from so-called black sites, where one sort of gets through the deep web and finds what it's actually like. And as Fred said at the beginning, the almost tragic comic contrast between the fiction of good taste airbrushed art published on the front page and the reality of what is being published. You know, that I'm not expecting digital links to ISIS bombings on every front page of the Times, but I would want a more conscious, a more purposeful, a more intentional, a more self critical relationship to pictorial beauty. That would seem the very least one one could ask for. What else? Any other sort of final thoughts, questions, concerns, pushback?
In the search, did you find any pictures that didn't really speak to the beauty of war, sort of told the truth or provided some insight into what's going on?
Well, some people think, you know, some people, I've been, you know, traveling on and off about the book over the last 2 months, both here, LA, I mean, all over New York and other places. And, you know, some people push back even against the very pictures in the book. Not everybody reads every photograph in the book the way that I do. And so some people find even in the book that not every picture is as glamorizing as I am reading it as. And then, as I say early on, that I tried my hardest out of self-preservation to talk myself out of the book, in the sense that, you know, I'm a writer, I'll be publishing more books. And, you know, it's not the most classic career move to publish a book that criticizes the Times. So I frankly, I've been thinking about this book on and off for really 20 years, ever since really the first Gulf War, as these pictures seem to me really weird. And then over the last few years, the project gained momentum. And once I gathered, I kept looking toward my research assistants, and I say, come on, you guys, find me those pictures that prove me wrong. Find me those pictures that are really conveying the horror of war. And, you know, all I can say is, you know, I'm sure someone could go back through those 9,000 pictures and find a couple of pictures that seem to them to be slightly grisly. But, you know, the Times photo editor herself, when I think it was Mother Jones magazine or somebody asked her for her commentary, the best that she could come up with was an image of someone who you can barely see. To me, in the perfect metaphor, she's covered underneath a plastic tarp. Like, God forbid that we see the human body. So, you know, to answer your question, pretty much no. So on that upbeat note, maybe I'll bring our proceedings to an end. Thank you, Fred. As always, a pleasure, and I'll be happy to answer whatever further questions you have at the book signing table. Thank you very much.